Hey, welcome to Crossroads YouTube channel. So glad you chose to join us. We are finishing up our series on 1 Timothy. We'll be in the 6th chapter, starting verse 11 through the end of that chapter. And we're looking at what it looks like to, as a faithful servant, to engage in that fight and to endeavor to live for the glory of God and to guard the gospel deposit that God's placed within us. And so we're glad that you're here. Enjoy. And hey, we just want to ask you to tune in next week as we start our new series, our Christmas series, our Advent series on the coming light. And we invite you to come and be a part of that also. Have a great day. And we know that there is a fight that we're engaged in. There's a fight that God's called us to be a part of. There's a fight that He's called every believer to engage in and to be a part of and to be a faithful servant, to be a faithful follower of Jesus in this fight that He's called us to wage war against the enemy, to wage war against the worldly desires, and to wage war against our own sinful desires. And that's the fight that we find ourselves in, and continuing will be in 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. I'm going to read verses 11 through the end of the chapter for us this morning. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 Timothy, 6th chapter, verse 11. It says, "But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and to Christ Jesus, who is the testimony before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ, which He will display at the proper time. He was blessed and sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in an approachable light, to whom no one has ever seen or can see, to Him honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, not to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good and to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasures for themselves as good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of what is truly life. O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you, and avoid irreverent babble and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge, for by professing it, some have swerved from the faith. Grace be with you." Let's pray this morning. Father, we're in desperate need of you. We're in desperate need of your grace to be here this morning, Lord, to give us hearts and minds to understand your word. Lord, I need you and you to fill me with your power and your presence to faithfully proclaim your word and your gospel this morning. So, Lord, I pray that you'd give us ears to hear and eyes to see and hearts to obey this morning your word, your holy word. God, that you might change us, that you might transform us. Lord, we don't come here just to hear a message. We come here to be changed, to be transformed, and we come here to give glory and honor and praise to the one who, and the only one who's worthy of our worship and worthy of our praise this morning, which is you. And so, Lord, we pray that we would turn our hearts to you. Lord, if there's one here today who doesn't know you, God, that you would come in this midst, that you would open their eyes to see the truth of your gospel, that you would draw them to salvation this morning, Lord, that they would give their hearts and their lives. And so, Lord, we thank you. And Lord, as we come later in this service to break this bread, to take of this drink, and to remember what you've done for us, Lord, that we would take this in a way that's worthy and honoring to you and to your Son Jesus, in whom He laid down His life for us, who broke His body for us, who shed His blood for us. God, may we be thankful this morning. May we be full of your grace this morning. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for praying with me this morning. So as we look at this passage and desire to finish up this message, we have this important thing we're going to do at the end of the service, and it's called the Lord's Supper. Now, we're doing a little different this morning. Had a lot of deacons that were out of town, and so we had to do it this way. And there's nothing wrong with doing it this way. It's just a little different. So at the end of the service, we're going to ask you to come, and you're going to pull a piece of bread off. You're going to dip it into the juice that's here, and then you're going to take that back to your seat and take the Lord's Supper. Now, here's the thing with this. This is an incredibly important thing that we do, and this is for believers. This is not a table that's for those who are unbelievers, and I say that because we love you. And if you're here and you don't know Jesus, and you're here, and I know it's a scary thing to show up in a church when you're not sure if you believe in the Lord and if you're following Him, but we say this because we love you, because the Bible speaks very clearly that those who partake of this table in an unworthy manner, in an unholy manner, bring condemnation upon themselves. They eat and drink condemnation on themselves, and that's the last thing that we want for you. But even as believers, that we need to come to these tables with caution. We need to come to these tables making sure that our hearts are right before the Lord, that we have not that there's not a broken relationship that we need to go make right before we come to these tables, that there's not some unrepentant sin in our hearts before we come and take these tables. So throughout this service, our heartbeat and our desire is that God would prepare our hearts to do this, to remember Him and His sacrifice. That's an important thing for us to do. As a church, it's one of the important ordinances that we do. It's one of the ways that we continue to preach the gospel to ourselves is when we sit and we take and remember what Christ has done for us, that He came, that He left heaven. He left the cries of holy, holy, holy to the cries of crucify, crucify, crucify. And He lived the perfect life that you could not live. And then He graciously laid down His life, and God slayed His Son on the cross as a payment for your sin and for my sin, so that our sins could be washed away. And then He was risen to new life so that we could be risen to new life. And so that's what we come when we come to these tables, is to remember what He's done for us. And we want to make sure that we come to these tables in a way that's honoring and glorifying to the sacrifice that was made, and that we remember Him this morning. So we want to make sure that God helps us to prepare our hearts for that as we work through His Word this morning. But as faithful servants, as we continue this engaging in this good fight and learning how we ought to engage in this good fight as God's people here at Crossroads, as faithful servants, we engage in the good fight when we endeavor to live for the glory of God and to guard the gospel deposit. And we see that throughout this text. We're going to begin unpacking what this means for us this morning, that God has called us to engage this fight, and we do that to live for the glory of God, that our endeavor, our aim in life, the one aim that you and I have, is that we would live for the glory of God and not for ourselves. That everything that we do here at Crossroads would not be about us, that it would be about the glory of God, and that we, in all that we do, would fight and engage in guarding the deposit that God placed in our hearts and our lives, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we would guard that we would fight for the gospel in everything that we do as His people and His church here at Crossroads. So as a faithful servant, he endeavors to live a life that's set apart for the glory of God. Verse 11, "But as for you, O man of God, flee these things, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness." Listen, when he starts this thing for Timothy, he says, "As for you, O man of God," we are set apart as God's people from the rest of this world. He's telling Timothy, you are set apart from the people in Ephesus. You are not to look and live like the people of Ephesus, that you are a man of God. And as a man of God, you are set apart. As for you, O man of God, you flee these things. Remember where we were last week, talking about the love of money, learning to be content. And he's talking about everything that he's been leading Timothy through the false teaching, through the false gospel, that you're to flee these things. You're to run away from these things. and that you're actually supposed to pursue some things. So we want to also not only flee from some things, flee from this world, flee from our sinful desires, flee from the schemes of the devil, but we also need to pursue some things, that we pursue righteousness and godliness and faith and love and steadfastness and gentleness. We have this one aim in life, and it is to live for the glory of God. So Paul says this also in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, verse 31. Now, I'm going to run through these verses because I'm just going to let you know we're probably going to go late today. Y'all just have to forgive me. I gave you a great break last week. So 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or you drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. It doesn't say just do these things. He says whatever you do. Even to the smallest things of everyday life, of eating and drinking, everything that you do ought to be done for the glory of God. Everything that we do here at Crossroads should be done for the glory of God. We preach for the glory of God. We do the Lord's Supper for the glory of God. We sing for the glory of God. We give for the glory of God. We share the gospel for the glory of God. We are faithfully serving this community for the glory of God, not the glory of Crossroads. May it never, ever be said that this is for us and not for Him. That this is our heartbeat, that this is our desires. In Revelation 4, the 11th chapter, it says this: worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. That He alone is the one that's worthy of glory. He alone is the one that's worthy of honor. He alone is the one that's worthy of our worship. He's worthy of our lives. Listen, in the catechism, in our Heidelberg Catechism, it says this, that what is the chief end of man? And we've talked about this before. It's to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. That's your chief end. That's the ultimate aim of all of humanity, is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. There should be no other aim. There should be no other motivation in our heart and in our lives except this: to live for the glory of God. Now that is a weighty thing to think about. That's a weighty thing to begin to try to wrap our minds around. And I know this, one of the very first messages that I ever preached to you was Psalms 115. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be glory forever and ever, according to your steadfast love and your faithfulness. That my God sits in the heavens and He does whatever He pleases. Amen. That's our God. He's going to get the glory. The question is, are our hearts postured in such a way, engaging this fight He's called us to for His glory and for His renown and for His fame and not ours? That our lives should be motivated by this one aim, this one idea, that we are His children. But as for you, O man of God, as for you, O woman of God, as for you, you child of God, that you would flee from the things of this world and that you would live for the glory of God. So how do we do that? How do we live for His glory? He says first to flee these things, to run from the things of this world. 1 Corinthians 6:18 says this: flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexual immoral person sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, from whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. In 1 Corinthians 10:13 and 14, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, But the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you may also be able to endure it. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. Throughout God's word, he is constantly, lovingly telling us as his people to flee temptation, to flee evil, to flee against your sinful desires, to flee against the passions of the world, and to flee from the devil's schemes. It's what we've been talking about week after week after week, that this is the good warfare that we wage against these things. And the only way that we can win that battle is with the Word of God and the power of God living in us, the Spirit of God. That this is the battle. This is Paul's summation of all of what he wants Timothy to know. He's putting it all together and going, Timothy, listen, you've got to flee these things. So I got some questions for you. What is it in your life that you're not fleeing from that you need to be fleeing from? Because I know that our tendency for some of us, and sometimes even me, is that I like to see just how close I can get to the line without actually going over it. You know, it's like when your kids sit in the car and they're saying, he's touching me, he's touching me, and they're really not, they're just really close. But that's what we do sometimes with sin. We want to see just how close we can get without actually sinning. And God's word tells us that we ought to be fleeing from it. We ought to be running away from it. So I wonder if there's some of you who maybe you're not getting the attention at home from your spouse that you need to be. And maybe there's someone giving you a little more attention at work and you're allowing that to creep into your heart. And you're enjoying that. You're actually flirting back a little bit. My caution to you, God's word to you, is that you need to flee. If you're shacked up with someone, living with someone who's not your husband or your wife and you're not married, my advice to you is that you flee. That you run from sin. That you not flirt with it. Sin always, always leads to death. It never leads to life. It may for a moment give you pleasure, but in the end, it only and always brings death. And God graciously, lovingly calls us to flee from it, to run from it, and to run to Him. This goes all the way back to the Old Testament when he says, listen, I've set before you life and death. Choose life. And what he's saying is, choose me. Run to me. Pursue me. Pursue righteousness. Pursue steadfastness. Pursue love. Pursue gentleness. That should be our heartbeat. We should be much more like Joseph with Potiphar's wife than we should ever be the other way. Because Joseph was a man of God. And he had great power over this household. And this lady came in, unrobed herself and said, here I am, you can have your way with me. And he didn't stand there and think, wow, she's pretty hot. No. He didn't think, wow, there's no one here and no one will ever know. I think I'm back on. Beat me up, Scotty. He never even hesitated. When she grabbed a hold of him, he literally ran out of his clothes. And he ran to the Lord. That should be the posture of our heart with everything. Now, I understand that there's some things, men, because men, we're very physical. We're very, very eye-oriented, and sometimes the way that our culture dresses today, you can't get away from it. You can be walking down the mall or walking down the beach, and you go, oh my gosh, they need some clothes on. But you need to discipline yourself, what I call the one-second rule. Sometimes you can't help but look, and there it is, but what your immediate response ought to be is, look at the clouds. Or look at my toes. That ought to be the response of our heart. To never gaze and never begin to entertain any of that. Much less to think about what some of you may be doing on the internet. And God is calling you, begging you to flee from those things. To run from those things. And that you might be a man of God, a woman of God, a child of God who would pursue righteousness and godliness and faith and love and steadfastness and gentleness. Listen, righteousness is this moral rightness. It's holiness. It's integrity. It's the whole thing that where Paul started with Timothy. Listen, you have to be above reproach in everything that you do, that you're to be holy. That this godliness means right worship and right living. That this faith means that we're putting our full trust in God. No matter what season of life, no matter how difficult the situation is, that I am trusting in the Lord. And I know that life gets hard. I know that it gets difficult. I know that there's seasons of life where you don't feel like I can get up today and move on. But His grace is sufficient. And that we, in those moments, must fully rest in Him and in His grace to get us through. That this love that we have, that we're to pursue, this selfless love, this steadfastness, this perseverance, this consistency in our lives, that we're to be gentle, that we're to have a kind, servant heart. Listen, we're to pursue these things. Grace, listen to me, grace is not opposed to effort. Grace is opposed to earning. Do you understand that? Grace is not opposed to you pursuing righteousness and holiness and gentleness and steadfastness. It is opposed to you trying to earn God's favor through doing those things. Because you cannot earn His favor. It is a grace of God. It is a gift of God that He gives us. So yes, we ought to be striving. We ought to be endeavoring to live for the glory of God. And we live for the glory of God when we pursue the things of God. And not the things of this world. That we ought to have this longing in our hearts to live for the glory of God. That's what a faithful servant has. If you're going to engage the good fight, we have to have this deep longing, passion in our hearts to live for His glory. And that as God's people, again, that our heart's cry would be, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to Your name be the glory forever and ever and ever. And not according to anything that we've done, but according to Your steadfast love and faithfulness, because You're faithful, because we're not. Lord, that this would be for Your glory. That when we take ornaments off of a tree to help provide Christmas for a child, that we're not doing that for our own glory, but that we're doing that for His glory. We're doing that the gospel might be proclaimed through that simple act of a Christmas gift, that they might know that there's a woman of God, a man of God, a child of God that loved them enough to give sacrificially so they might have something, that might point them to the cross of Jesus, that it might point to the glory of God in the way that we live. Now, I know that's just verse 1, and it's already 11:30. So verse 12 says this in 13. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you gave and made the good confession. In the presence of many witnesses, I charge you, in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and to Christ Jesus, who is his testimony before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession. Listen, faithful servants endeavor to live lives in view of eternity, that we need to stop thinking and living in the temporal world, that we need to start living our lives in view of eternity, meaning that this is not our home, that my home is somewhere else. It's not here. That my home is with Jesus, and Jesus is in heaven, and that's where my home is. Amen. That's how we ought to live our lives, in view of eternity, not in view of what I need today or what I need tomorrow, but oh, what I need for the life ever after. That would be the posture of our hearts, that this what we endeavor to live for, that we would live with a heart that's focused on eternity, that we would fight to live this life, that we would fight the good fight of fighting for the glory of God in everything that we do, because this is really what life is all about. So take hold of what is already yours. He says, Timothy, take hold of what's already yours. He already has eternal life. He's already been given, according to Ephesians 1:3, every spiritual blessing in heaven is ours. We need to take hold of what is already ours and believe that God has given it, that God has called us to it. The grace that we see in this verse that says that God called you to. That apart from God calling you, apart from God working in your hearts, in your lives, there's no hope for us. We're spiritually dead before we ever came to know Jesus. There was nothing alive in me. If you're here and you don't know him, you're spiritually dead. And God, by his grace, has called you here today to hear this message, to hear this word, to call you to give your heart and your life to him. Because apart from him, there is no life. And my hope is, my prayer is that today he might open up your hearts by his grace and his mercy, that he might help you to see your deep need of him. That you might see your lostness, that you might see just how far you are from him and his holiness. Colossians 3:1 says this, if you then have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. That's where our home is. That Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and that our life is hidden in him, in God. That our life literally is in heaven. That's our eternal place that we're going. That one day, yes, we will get to go and be with our Savior, where there'll be no more tears and no more clouds like we sang today. And what a day of rejoicing that will be, right? But my question is that what our hearts really long for? Do our hearts really long to be with Jesus, or do we just want another day? Just give me another. I mean, if there's more that I want to do, Lord, just let me stay here a little longer. Let me preach one more sermon. I mean, my heart ought to be, Lord, if this is the last one, praise be to God, because I'm with you. Man, that would be my heart, that would be the heart's of his people here, that we would truly live in the view of eternity. Now here's this thing. This is a massive verse in here. Whereas Timothy, this confession that you made in the presence of many witnesses. And some of you have done the same very thing, that you've placed your faith and your trust in Jesus. And at some point, you followed him in baptism. And in that baptism, you were proclaiming the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That you were identifying that you died with him, that you've been risen to new life with him, and that he is your Lord and Savior. And you've made that confession before many people, many of you before people who are here right now, that they've seen you make that confession. That I've been here for see some of you make that good confession that Jesus is my Lord. He says, in front of all of those witnesses, I'm charging you to be faithful. And then he goes on further and says, I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus. There's a weightiness here. There's a view of eternity that you need to have, that you are going to be held accountable to God for this life that you live. That you're going to be held accountable to God for how you fight this fight that he's called us to. That God's going to hold you accountable for the things that you do with the resources that he's given you. It says that God gives us all things. That everything that we have is from him. That you are not your own. That God owns you. He created you. He made you. He gets to do whatever he wants to in your life. And you don't have a right to refuse any of it. But know this, that he's good, and he's gracious, and he's loving, and nothing that God does for us is not ever, ever is it not for our good. So before God this morning, before the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, I charge you and I charge myself that we fight the good fight. That we understand that God's going to hold us accountable for what we do here at Crossroads. That God's going to hold me as the pastor responsible for what we do here at Crossroads. To whether we fight the good fight, that whether we hold up the gospel, whether we live for his glory, that we are accountable to God. One day you're going to stand before him and you're going to give an account. Now listen, as a believer, you're going to be judged for your works, not for your salvation. I don't ever have to worry about standing before the judgment seat of God. Okay, as a believer, I don't have to worry about it. If you're not a believer and you leave this earth, then you're going to stand before the judgment seat of God and you will be condemned to hell forever. As a believer, I don't have to worry about that. But I know this, the longing in my heart is that when I stand before him, that what I would hear is, well done, my good and faithful servant. Not that I would stand before him and go, David, what did you do with all of those years? What did you do with all of those resources that I gave you? David, why did you waste your life on pursuing the things of the world and not the things of heaven? My hope is that that would never, ever be what I hear. That would be what you would never, ever hear. That we, as a church, that God would look at us and say, well done, my good and faithful servants. Well done. So don't shrink back from this calling. Listen, Jesus says this in Luke, the 9th chapter, verse 62. Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hands to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. That's pretty harsh, isn't it? That this fight that God's called us to live, this battle that God's called us to engage, this life of living for the glory of God, that we cannot shrink back from it. Once we've made that confession, once we've laid our hands to the plow, there's no looking back and going, hey, I'm not sure I'm cut out for this. That we need to help each other keep our hands to the plow, keep our eyes focused on the things of God and the things of heaven, the things of eternity, and on the glory of God. That we need each other for that. Now listen, that does not mean that there's not grace when we falter. God is gracious and loving and always seeks His forgiveness, is always there. That you're His child and He loves you. That He loves you. Listen, this good fight, this gospel fight that we're in is not a gospel of comfort, it's not a gospel of health, and it's not a gospel of wealth. That this gospel that we preach, this gospel that we've embraced, calls you, bids you to come and die. Not to be comfortable, not to have it easy, but to come and die. That's the call of the gospel for us. So verse 14 through 16, it says, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which He will display at the proper time. He who is blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwells in an unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To Him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Now listen, we could stay there for about a month. But the point of that is that's who you're going to be held accountable to. That we're held accountable to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who is in unapproachable light, who is holy. There is this holy otherness about God that we will never, ever be able to comprehend. And it's to Him that we're going to give an account for the life that we live and what we do with it. So as a faithful servant, in these verses, we also see that we're to obey the Word of God. Keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach. We talk about this all the time. It's in our statement that we've been talking about. We cannot fight this battle apart from what? The Word of God. That we're in desperate, desperate need of God's Word every single day. It's why we provide a reading plan for you, just to help you so that you have a way to, listen, this is what I need to do today. And we don't read to finish, do we? We read to change. We read to be transformed. So when you open up God's Word, it's not just, oh, I've got to have my quiet time today and check that off my list. No, God, will You change my life? Will You help me be obedient to Your Word? Would You help me just to be obedient to the great commandment? That I would love the Lord God with all of my heart, all of my mind, and all of my soul. That God, that You, as Your grace, that You would give this church a grace of being able to say that we love God with all of our heart, all of our mind, and all of our soul. That we would just strive to be obedient to that one thing. Everything else would be taken care of. And that we would love our neighbor as ourselves. All the laws and all the prophets hang on those two commandments. If we get those right, everything else will be fine. That we would be obedient to the Word of God. That we would endeavor to be found faithful upon His appearing and His coming again. Do you realize that He's coming? It's on His timing. There's coming a time when He's going to crack the sky and He's going to bring His people home. He's going to gather up His church and He's going to bring us home. and that our heartbeat would be that we would be faithful to His Word until that happens. That as a church, that we would be found faithful to keep the commandments of God until He cracks that sky and comes home, or we go home before them. That we would be faithful, that we would endeavor to fight this good fight. Look at verses 17. I'm trying to push it along. It says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, not to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. Now, I'm going to stop right there because I need to address something here. Now, I know some of you are thinking, well, this doesn't apply to me because I'm certainly not rich. Well, I'm just going to have to correct your thinking. Because it's easy for us to be in this context, in this culture, and to look around at all the wealth and all that some people amass and that they have and go, there's no way that I'm wealthy. There's no way that you can say that this text applies to me. But listen to this. There are 300 million people who live in the U.S. There's 7.2 billion people who live in the world. If you make $40,000 a year, you're in the top 1% of the richest people in the world. Some of you thinking, uh-oh, maybe I am rich. Didn't know it. There's never been a time where the people or massive people have had the wealth that we have in any of the history of the world. So this text applies to us greatly. You can't sit here today and say, well, I'm not rich. This doesn't apply to me. I don't have to apply this to my life. No. You are top 1% of the most wealthy people in the world. And the reason for that is that 3 billion of those 7.2 billion in the world live on $2 a day. And 1.3 billion of them live on $1 per day. So our charge here in this, in this present age, that those of us who are rich, those of us who have much, that we would not be haughty, that we would not be prideful, that we would be generous people, that we would live generously. Listen, the poorest person in this room is some of the richest people in the world. Do we get that? You might even be below that 40,000, but even you in that current state, the poorest person sitting in this room today is among the richest in the world. And the question is, are we stewarding our lives well? Are we, as a faithful servant, endeavoring to steward our lives well? That we have a humble heart? Do we understand that my identity is not in what I possess and what I have, it's in whom I know? That the posture of our hearts ought to be that I want to live a generous life. That's the life of every believer. It's the call of every believer because Jesus generously gave us everything. We get that right, that He left heaven, that He came and humbled Himself in form of us, a man, fully God, fully man, lived a holy, perfect life, was accused of all kinds of horrible, terrible things, and ultimately laid down His life, gave His life for us. He set the example of what it means to be sacrificial in the way that you live, in the things that you do with your life. And Jesus, who came, had an eternal perspective because the Scriptures tells us He didn't even have a place to lay His head. Foxes have holes to live in, but I don't even have a rock to place my head on. Jesus understood. He came into this world without nothing. He would leave with nothing. in his humanness. And that should be our perspective, that we would desire to steward our lives. Well, listen, Proverbs 16:5 says, "Everyone who is arrogant in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Be assured, he will not go unpunished." That our hearts need to be humble and not haughty and not arrogant. That we know this, that a person who stewards their lives well know that all that we have comes from God and he owns it all. Do you understand that everything that you have is a blood-bought gift? That he owns it all and he has generously given to us what we have so that we might live for his glory in what he's given to us. Not in the comfort of it, but for his kingdom and for his glory. Like I guys told you last week that we're looking for a house, and these past couple of weeks in these messages about being content, it's a good place, but not always a fun place to be when you're looking for a home. Because we've just been wrestling with, where does God want us? Where does he want to place us? What's not too much and what's just enough? What's exactly what we need? And what do you want us to have, God? So that we might have more for your kingdom, not more for ourselves. That you might give us a place, Lord, that would be a light in a dark world. That you might give us a place, Lord, where we can have people over and love on them and show them the gospel. But Lord, also, we don't want to be so financially strapped that we can't generously give to those who are in need and to give to your kingdom. So Lord, would you just help us with that? Pray for us, because we're still looking. They understand this, that wealth is uncertain. They have convictions of generosity of what it really looks like to live a generous life. Now here's a staggering statistic for those of us talking about stewarding our lives well. As God's people, as this whole church, that 6% of Christians tithe. Only 6% of the wealthiest people in this country tithe. Who are believers. Now, I don't know how you match that up with Malachi 3. That said, God says, this is what I've required of you. I've required that you give 10%, and how dare you rob me? That some of us have been robbing God for a long time. And we come here and we sing songs and think we're okay with God when we're not. That God requires at least the minimum of 10%. And again, I tell you this all the time, that's the starting point for us. That's why we as a church, come on the December 11th, we're going to vote that we're going to move from 10% as a church to 15%. That as a church, we're going to lead an example for you so that you might grow. That we as a family, that Julie and I are going to give more and more and more as God gives us grace to do that. And as we learn to live on less, to give more. That we would steward our lives well for the kingdom. Listen, the gospel demands that we be generous. Because Jesus was generous to us. Listen, you don't need more money. You don't need a better marriage. You don't need a better job. You don't need a better life. You need Jesus. He's all we need. So when you sing songs like, he's my everything, is he really? Is that really our perspective? Is that really how we're stewarding our hearts and our lives? Listen, all you got to do is look at your checkbook and you'll know what you're giving yourself to. Just examine, just take a look and go, how faithful am I being? Now, I know some of you are sitting here, I don't like it when preachers talk about money. All I can tell you is Jesus talked a lot about it. And it's here, and I'm not ashamed to preach it and teach it and tell you the truth. But I'll make this commitment. I'm going to try to live it out with everything that I have. I'm not going to ask you to do something that I'm not willing to do. that I'm going to sacrifice, and I'm going to ask you to sacrifice, and I'm not going to ask you to sacrifice where I'm not willing to sacrifice. That we and listen, and I want to compliment on you. You are a giving church. You really are. We've given so much this year, and we talked about that last week, of just how gracious and kind you've been to give when there's a need. And I want to thank you for your faithfulness. I want to thank you for how you've been faithfully giving. And some of you, man, you have just been giving and giving, but there are some of you, you haven't been brought to that point of understanding. Man, there is such a blessing in giving. And some of you haven't grown in that area of your life yet. I'm just encouraging you before God, before Jesus today, that you just examine your heart and your life and your checkbook. And honestly ask yourself, am I stewarding my life and my resources for the glory of God? Because if that's really true of us, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, it'll show up in our checkbook. God makes that tie between money and our hearts all the time. Throughout the scriptures, he makes that clear to us. And then he says to Timothy, all right, I got to wrap this thing up. 1 Timothy, look at verses 20. O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Avoid the irreverent babble and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge, for the professing it, some have swerved from the faith. A faithful servant endeavors to guard the gospel deposit. What he's challenging Timothy here is, Timothy, be faithful to the gospel. Be faithful to live it. Be faithful to preach it. Be faithful to live it out in your life. Timothy, continually, always preach the gospel to yourselves. I hope you do that every day. I hope you wake up preaching the gospel to yourself. Because listen, this pastor, this preacher needs the gospel every single day. I need to tell myself about the gospel. I need to remind myself about the gospel every single day. Every single day, I need to remember what Jesus has done for me. Not just when we do communion, but every single day that I would remember that God laid down his life for me, that Jesus shed his blood for me. Every single day, I need the gospel. Every single day, you need the gospel preached to you over and over and over in your heart so that we might guard against false teaching. That we might guard against the sinful nature, that we might guard against the attachment to the world, that we might guard ourselves against the schemes of the enemy, that we would guard our hearts and our lives. Listen, 2 Corinthians 5th chapter, verses 17 through 21, Paul says this, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Amen? Amen? All this is from God, who through Christ Jesus reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliations. Therefore, we are ambassadors of Christ Jesus. God is making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. That we have this massive obligation that God's given us, this massive grace that God has given us to be his ambassadors, to be a church, to be a people, to be every man, woman, and child, that we would guard the gospel message of Jesus Christ. that we would preach it to ourselves, that we would hold it in our hearts, that we would remind ourselves continuously of what Jesus has done for us, and that we would be continually reminded that God has called you to proclaim the gospel, to preach the gospel in this world, because there is no other hope. And as we are people who live faithfully for the glory of God, as we guard the gospel, that in that process, that what God's word tells us happen is that the Spirit of God, that God himself through us is imploring your neighbor and your worker and your family member that they would come to him, that they would be reconciled to God, that literally God desires to use your life to cause people, to call people, to beg to them to come to him, to be reconciled to him. What a grace that we get to live a life that absolutely matters. That God gives us this calling in our lives, the grace of being called his ambassador, that we get to faithfully take the gospel. That's why we're going to go back to that neighborhood and pray for people and pray over that neighborhood so that God, on one of those doors that we knock on, that God would be pleading for them to come to him. We just have to be faithful to be his ambassadors, to go and represent him there. Amen? So we're getting ready to sing. Now I know I've gone long, and thank you, you always give me grace in that. But we're getting ready to sing a song before we take the Lord's Supper that says, come to this altar. Oh, come to the altar. And my hope is that as we've talked through this passage this morning, that you've been preparing your heart to come and take these tables, and we're going to give you an opportunity, whether that's right there in your seat, right here at this altar, that you would literally go before the throne of God, that you would go before his altar this morning, and that you would make sure that your heart is right with him. And if you're here today and you don't know him, you've never placed your faith and your trust in him, I invite you to come this morning. Come to this altar and surrender everything to him. And he's waiting. He's waiting. Do you get the picture of that? That every day, our Savior prepares a table for us. He just is waiting for us to come. Just waiting for us to come to the altar and just to meet with him. Oh, what grace of God. That he graciously, lovingly, tenderly calls us to come and just to be there with him. My prayer is that you would respond to him, that you would meet him as he waits for us in this place this morning. Would you come? Stand with me as we sing.